No.
Calvin. Calvin is going to start tonight's performance.
Is that right?
I hope so. Which, of course, Alicia. Alicia might introduce herself later on.
Yeah. Good. That'd be nice.
Thank you. got the warrant.
Thank you.
Thank you. Don't take me, 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 don't gentlemen, Lisa Allmark. Allmark. Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to play some more from Lisa Allmark.
Lisa Allmark, yes.
Yes.
Oh!
Thank you, sure.
Thank you.
I'm off. I've been off for a long time.
Yes, that's
I'm
really off this time. Hi, I'm Lisa. I'm Japanese. I've been living here from April with my boyfriend. And I'm going to here maybe until October. 6 months. So wait. In Japan, I've been working as a master of ceremony at wedding reception. Do you know? Congratulations, everyone! And for 8 years, I work as a master of ceremony. I started this work after divorce. Two divorces are very heavy, you know? Anyway, during each ceremony, I say to the guest, congratulations, happy wedding, and wish you a long happiness. Thank you very much for everyone. I repeated such beautiful words many times over. One day I noticed how this makes me feel good and happy, even if I feel down. I found that very interesting, so I started thinking why I feel so. When we feel down, we sigh and deep voice. How can I say? Anyway, like this. Doing like this, we relax and heal our body and heart. It's important to output to keep a balance of life. And also, vibration can heal us. Voice is one of the vibration. Understand? My English is poor, I know. If you know this fact, you will be able to make yourself happy anytime. So I started to write a song that could heal everybody from 1 year ago. Now I'm going to play this song, Iroha ni Koheto. Iroha ni Koheto is Japanese. It's an old Japanese poem, you know, very popular in Japan. It's a miracle poem. How miracle? We use 50 hiragana letter in Japan, so that English uses 26 alphabet. This poem is comprised of 50 hiragana letters without using the same hiragana letter once. Can you imagine? It's a miracle, okay? Now, it's difficult to explain all of this poem's meaning, so I understand this poem in this way. This world and our life are very beautiful. Now, now we can see and touch and hear the wonderful things around us. But the world may also be an illusion. Nobody knows what is true. I like this poem very much. So, wrote music for it. So please listen. Iroha ni koheto. Thank you.
are in 3 minutes' time. We're going to continue 5 minutes' time downstairs with the next performance. The next performance is going to be micro stories, some vitriolic, wonderful, boring micro stories from the great and wonderful, very, very exciting and beautiful Mr. Mark Rathmull. One thing about all of us here tonight, most of us, in fact, live in the shadows of the Titans, and the Titans are on the march, and the Titans are going to take over if we allow them. What might happen is the Titans might leave. When the Titans leave, we're going to retake the city. And when we retake the city, we'll set up a sound system in the Gherkin. From the epicentre of the city, we will have music. We will have people living in all of the tower blocks rather than exploiting the people. And the oligarchs will leave. This is the plan. Okay, 5 more minutes and we'll be downstairs and we shall perform. Thank you very much.
Watching films. When I watch a film, I always like like the bit at the beginning where everyone's happy, before it all starts to go wrong. And if I'm honest, after the beginning bit finishes and all the bad things start to happen, I'd rather just fast forward to the end where it's all over and everybody's happy again. And hopefully no one's been killed, or no one that I like anyway. I just cannot see the appeal in watching the middle bit. All that suspense and tragedy, it's just stressful. Why put yourself through it? I'd rather go and do something else. My partner's gotten used to me asking to be told when the middle part's finished so I can come back and watch the ending. If I like the ending enough, then I might watch the beginning a bit again, just to celebrate. In between that, I might pop down to the supermarket to choose a nice bottle of wine for us for the end of the film, and my partner can fill me in on what I've missed in the middle bit. Choosing a nice bottle of wine is a nicer way to pass the time. That's it, really. Parker. Mum! Keith won't give me my Parker back! Keith, give Mark his Parker, it's cold outside! Mum, he still won't! Keith, why won't you give Mark his Parker? Mum, he says I'm not mod enough! Keith, I'm getting tired of this, give him the bloody Parker! Mum! Keith! Mum! Keith! Mum! Keith! Give him the bloody Parker and go and live with your dad! This is a longer one, it's called Andy Shandy. I have a dear friend who is an abject alcoholic called Andy Shandy. He's called Andy Shandy because a shandy is the only alcoholic drink he's ever been known to refuse. He says it symbolises everything that's wrong in the world, and it's an insult to even a bad lager. Andy is one of the most intelligent people I've ever met, which can be hard to believe when you see him, hands shaking, lifting a bottle of strong cider to his mouth, and while he holds it there with both hands and sucks on the bottle as though his life depended on it, he wets himself. This I have seen. Andy likes to take me out for a drink occasionally, and I always accept. Not just for the erudite conversation and laser wit he offers, but because it's very, very cheap. One day he might take me to the canal to share a bottle of vodka with some lemonade in plastic cups as we watch the barges go by. Another he might take me to share several bottles of white wine in the outdoor area at the Barbican Centre, which is arguably one of the most pleasant places to drink in London, were it not for the fact that the day he took me it was drizzling in February. But we wrapped up warm. The other afternoon he called on me and said he wanted to take me for a liquid lunch in the city. I was fairly sure it wouldn't have been to one of the bars where all the bankers drink in their lunch times, but I was curious. We walked down past the Moorgate area into a pleasant little square with benches and flowers everywhere, and we chose a bench off to one side. The only other people in the square were city workers having their packed lunches. Andy got out the drinks. Special surprise. White lightning cider. Yummy. After a couple of cans each, the conversation was flowing and I was enjoying myself so much we could have been drinking in the loveliest pub garden in the country. Just then we were approached by a security guard. "Excuse me, sir, no alcohol is allowed in the square. I'm going to have to ask you to leave." He directed this to Andy, not me. That's because Andy looked like a homeless Russian poet and I didn't. Andy replied with a mischievous glint in his eye, "On whose authority? Is this a City of London directive?" "No, this is a privately owned square, sir." "Well, why are you allowing this common filth to eat their revolting corporate sandwiches here, then?" "They're not drinking alcohol, sir. Come on. Hang on. How can a public square be privately owned?" "This whole area is privately owned, sir." "By whom?" "I'm not at liberty to disclose that, sir." "You don't know, do you?" "It's private, sir." "Well, I don't believe you. Looks pretty public to me. Look, members of the public everywhere." "Come on, sir." "No, seriously, I want you to show me the deeds of ownership. If it turns out this square is genuinely privately owned, I will leave quietly." After I've had a piss. That was it. The guard grabbed Andy and hauled him up by his shoulders and promptly landed flat on his back. See, the other thing about Andy that you've never realised to look at him is he's got a black belt in taekwondo from when he stopped drinking for a couple of years in his early 30s. He did nothing but taekwondo for 7 days a week until he couldn't stand being sober anymore. So the guard's on the ground, Andy having deftly taken his ankle from underneath him. Andy allows him to get up and then pitches him forward onto his stomach, kneels on his spine and pulls one of his arms up right behind his back. The guard yelps in pain. By now we're attracting attention. People are filming us on their smartphones. "Andy, we're being filmed," I say. "Perhaps we should leave, rapidly." "No! Get their contact details. I want the rights to this footage. I've been thinking about this for a long time. I want to start a business." "What business?" "I want to start a YouTube channel. Alkies against corporate fascism." How to make money out of a YouTube channel? Advertising! Andy, that's a bit, well, ironic, don't you think? No, ethical advertising. I thought it all through. Get their details. But by now the security guard had vomited and started crying. People were backing away. It didn't look so good anymore. Reinforcements were running towards us from the other side of the square. Oh, bloody bollocks, Andy said, and we ran. We got away, but we left the cider, which Andy was very upset about. But we did discuss his idea further, and we agreed the name wasn't quite right. So we had a brainstorming session, and we came up with a much better one. The Kill Gentrification League, or KGL. It has a ring to it, like a cross between the KGB and the KLF. He's made me branch secretary for Hackney.
Drink. I need 5 minutes to get ready.
Okay.
Do you like my prints? These pictures on the wall here are prints that I made during a residency at Great Art, the shop down the road, which the gallery arranged for me.